And then they saw me in a bra, and that was it.
Merhaba. Hi, everyone. This is Canan from Turkey, and you're listening to Single Podcast Theory with Brad Lyons and Brad Blazek.
What's going on, Pearl Jam nerds? You're listening to Single Podcast Theory. I'm Brad Lyons.
And I'm Brad Blazek.
What's up?
Hey, man.
This is one latest nights we've had as far as recording.
Yeah.
It's kind of, I feel like I got my tired smoky voice on.
Yeah. Hey. Hey, Pearl Jam nerds.
What's going on, Pearl Jam nerds?
It's a quiet storm with Brad and Brad.
I should get into VO.
That's some thunder for you. You should get what?
I should do some VO work.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Just get real tired and walk into the studio and read copy for
smoke
people.
Smoke a cigarette.
Oh, man. All right, so.
How you feeling?
Am I feeling?
Oh,
man.
You sound better.
Oh, yeah. Hopefully I sound a lot better. I feel 1,000 times better than I did last week. I felt so bad for everyone having to listen. You have no idea how many of the sniffles I took out. And there was still like 1,000 in there. So,
yeah.
My apologies.
I was listening and Susan came in. She's like, oh my God, Brad sounds so pitiful.
I was, man. I don't get pitiful too often when I'm sick, but that day it was just like, man, fuck this. Sucks. So, how was your week?
It's all right.
You had a long day today, man.
Yeah, today was crazy.
Did you say you had a delivery that was 90 miles one way?
90 minutes.
90 minutes.
90 miles would have been awesome. Now, about an hour and a half one way.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Well, did you listen to some Riot Act?
I did.
In the car?
I did.
Yeah, in the truck?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, man. So this is episode 44. We're finally getting to Riot Act.
The people demand it.
Yeah, man. We have actually had quite a few people ask for it, so it's cool. What was I about to say? I don't remember now. I'm the worst.
Long week?
It was a good week. Yeah, it was a long week, but it was a good week. Yeah, hey, man. It's
long day.
Long weekend this weekend.
Wow, for some people.
Well, for me it is.
For the artist types.
Oh, please. Oh, please.
Some people have to work.
I'm not going to respond to that. Do you have Sunday and Monday off?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Your normal?
But yeah, that's my normal
days off
anyway. Yeah. So.
All right.
Going out to the lake tomorrow.
Oh, that's right, dude. Whose lake are you going to? Glad you didn't call it the beach.
The Earth's lake? Whose lake?
Well, I mean, do you have a boat? Is there just like a public dock that you're going to? Or are you just... What do you mean when you say you're going to the lake?
My nephew's got a boat, so he's coming with a bunch of his friends, and I think he needs an adult to drive the boat because everyone's going to be partying.
Oh, gotcha.
So he asked me.
Doesn't make any sense. You party so hard.
Oh, I know, dude. I do.
I'm really nervous about the Chicago trip. You're just going to be off the fucking rails, dude.
Yeah, man. You know what they say about, like, when you get drunk, it just, like, amplifies your assholery. So you
some people
get ready.
See, I was the opposite. I was a fucking teddy bear. But... That didn't really work out for me.
I'm fine. I uncovered some pictures from my partying youth.
Oh, really?
I should send them to you. They're so...
Please
so
do. Oh, my God. How old were you?
Oh, like... God, I had it be 19?
Oh, a 19-year-old Brad B. Oh, my God. Just the sexual gravitas you must have been throwing around. Woo.
It's bad. Oh, it's bad.
Man, 19-year-old Brad B. Would we, if we had met when you were 19, would we be friends?
Yeah, I think so.
You think so?
Why not?
I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you think back, like, you know, people I was friends with at certain points in my life, especially in those years, like early 20s, you know, late teens. I would never be friends with some of those people now. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Just how people change or right. You change, you know?
No, I think I'm pretty much the same.
I believe that,
I probably
actually.
Would be intimidated by you.
That's weird. I'm super intimidating.
Not like you're going to beat me up, but just like, I don't know. You're like a cool guy. You're like a cool musician guy.
Oh, okay.
So I would have... I like that part of you.
Oh, God. Not, all right, so let's do this, man.
Yeah, can you tell it's late?
Yeah, I know. This is terrible. All right, let's do our email thing with Pearl Jam story time.
Good evening. This is Storytellers. We are here to tell stories.
We just have friends up here that are listening to stories.
Have I got a little story for you?
This is the true story.
All right.
All right. We got Maria that wrote in. God, when was this from? How far?
I think April
11th.
Yeah. Man.
Go for it.
Do you have her email right in front of you?
I do.
Okay. Well, that... Whatever. All right. Hi, Brad. Hello, Brad. I don't know who's who.
It doesn't matter. I'm the high,
yeah. Brad. Okay. Yeah, man.
Oh, I didn't mean like
because you like to get high.
Oh, my God. I'm so high right now.
I've been a listener since February and am slowly catching up to all the episodes. Thanks for keeping me company while I make dinner. I just finished the Pearl Jam 20 episode while making eggplant moussaka.
Yeah, dude.
What is that? I don't even know what that is. Do you?
I think I'm pretty sure it's an Indian dish. I could be wrong, though.
I love eggplant, so I probably...
Do you really?
On some, yeah.
Oh, I thought you wouldn't.
Why?
Because it's a vegetable. Yeah. Because it's a plant.
Okay. It's not fried. I mean, I like if it's fried and like got cheese on it.
Exactly.
And you
okay,
can't
cool.
You can't really no, tell. You right. Can't really tell
you're
what
not even
it is.
Tasting the eggplant. Yeah. Okay. Cool.
Something one of you guys said resonated with me. I completely understand the bit of sadness felt with watching young, green, bright, and bushy-tailed Ed of the early interviews morph into angsty Eddie that most people, i.e. non-Pearl Jam fanatics, think of when they think of Pearl Jam at all. But I'll add to this that now he seems to have happily settled into his place of celebrity. Hanging out with movie stars, performing at the Oscars, and even more shocking to me, playing corporate gigs for Oracle and Citibank. I don't mean for that to come across as snarky as it may sound. I know that doing a Citibank show can allow him to play a tiny venue again. But do you know what I mean? It's just weird to me. It is. I was thinking about this today. We've talked about this, but like, just their ticket prices are so high.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
But, and it's strange... but I mean, I don't care though. I mean, it's a business, you know,
sure.
And they put a lot of money back into the community and what do you call that stuff?
Philanthropy.
Yeah. There you go. As a fan since almost the beginning, 1992 for me, it's pretty neat to follow the growth of a person professionally and in some glimpses personally. It seems like Eddie has struck a good balance of living the good life while still being a good, generous person. I guess that this applies to the whole band. Yep. That's what I was trying to say, and she said a lot better. Eddie is pretty much my hero. I really admire how he has conducted his career with such integrity and has been a champion of so many causes, using his privilege to help less fortunate people and call attention to human and environmental issues. I adore that he's a feminist. Again, this applies to the whole band. But the one thing Eddie has done for me and countless others is how he can paint a picture of the human experience with his lyrics. I recently lost a friend, and Light Years and Long Road have helped me immensely in my grief. So here's the story of when I met my hero. Back in 2011, Eddie played two solo shows in Oakland, California. After the show of the first night, my friend suggested that we wait outside the venue for him to come out. Fuck it. Sure, why not? Let's hang out in a dark alley in Oakland. That was me in Memphis. Memphis 2013 at 1 in the morning.
Oh.
Ooh. So we waited in the line of 25 patient fans. After about an hour, his security guard came out and said, no autographs, no pictures. For a slight second, I was bummed. But then I realized that meant I wouldn't fuck up a moment I've waited most of my life for by fumbling with a phone to get a picture that would probably end up lost or deleted anyway. My heart pounded as I watched him listen to each fan while shaking their hand, and my mind flooded with about a billion things I wanted to tell him. I wanted to thank him for writing music that got me through life. Side note, I did not want this to end up like the time I met Marilyn Manson when I was 16. Quote, you rock. You really do.
Unquote. Oh, no. I feel you on that one, Maria. I'm cringing with you.
I've had those moments. He approached, not much taller than me, and shook my hand. I enclosed both of my hands around his surprisingly very soft hands, looked into his blue eyes that seemed to glow in the dark, and I said, you mean so much to me. He blinked and quietly responded, whoa. I let go, ran a few feet away, and sobbed. Fuck, I lost my cool. But I told him, that's all that mattered. I kind of got a little choked up reading that.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Like,
I would do the same thing. On the night of the second show, I had to wait and connect with him again. During the second show, he told a story about the Bridge School benefit in 2010, which I attended. A little backstory about Bridge School 2010. At that show, everyone was glued to their phones because the Giants were in the playoffs or some big sports ball event. The win would have meant they would go to the World Series. So you can imagine the energy of the show that night. In addition to Pearl Jam, Billy Idol played that year. During a random moment in his set, the entire crowd erupted in a massive cheer because the Giants won, and Billy, bless his heart, thought the applause was for him and started to cheer for himself. Fast forward a year later to the second night of Eddie's solo show, and he's telling this story with the same observation that I had. Quote, I think he thought all the applause was for him, unquote. So after the show, I waited outside again for another hour for him to come out. And when he did, I said, hey, Eddie, I'm so glad you told that Billy Idol Giant story. I wondered the same thing. And I began mimicking the jumping cheer Billy Idol did. And Eddie started to crack up and held his hand to his belly. Then he said with a laugh, yeah, he was grabbing his crotch. while pretending to grab his own crotch. So there you have it. I may have freaked out my idol one night, but was able to have a laugh with him the next. Thanks for letting me share this story with you guys. There were a few years when I kind of placed Pearl Jam on the back burner. It's fun to have this virtual community online of Pearl Jam nerds. This podcast has helped me reignite my passion for this band to the point where I'm constantly talking about the random memories and factoids to my boyfriend. Yeah, whatever, Dave. All you talk about is the Warriors. Yeah. Sorry, Dave. One last thing before I send this. I had two wishes for 2018, for Pearl Jam to tour again and to finally visit Chicago. I got both of my wishes. The last time I saw a proper full Pearl Jam show was in 2013, so I am stoked. And she created a Spotify list, like, to get people ready for Wrigley. So
hell yeah, man.
I'm going to try and share that probably on Facebook and Instagrams and all that. She said, that's it. Keep it up, guys. Thanks.
Sweet. Thanks for that email.
Yeah. Maria, thank you.
Boom.
I wish I could meet Eddie. I know, like, everyone does, you know? But just reading stuff like this, I'm like, oh, please, someday.
That'd be cool.
So I can run away sobbing into your arms. Brad, hold me, Brad Lyons.
Just come here, buddy. Come here. Yeah. Pat you on the head as you tear and snot into my shoulder.
I'm sorry about Dissident Eddie.
What if that happened? What if you actually met him? And I mean, this is so outlandish, but. Right. He had heard some of the podcast, and he was like,
oh, God.
I personally think Dissident's a great song, Brad B. Right. And then just walked away from you.
Yes. That's probably what will happen. It'll be like the greatest but worst moment of my life.
Yeah.
Because, like, I've met, like, musicians before that I really admire. Mm-hmm. And I'm always, like, scared to death that I'm going to say something to I don't know. Just upset them, like, not on purpose, but they take it the wrong way and they're like, fuck you, dude, and they get on the bus and I'm like, no.
They're looking out the bus window that you can't see. It's like the one way, and you're just standing there, like, but they can't hear you, but they can tell that you're screaming your head off, you're red in the face and sweaty, and your arms are just flailing in the air. And that's his last and only memory of you.
All the other fans know I'm, like, the asshole, so I'm, like, a pariah.
You fucked it up.
I fucked it up, man.
Oh, God. Hey, hold on a second. I just heard a weird noise in my cans. I want to make sure nothing's going on.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Weird noises are not good. Brad Lyons is so on edge right now because it took us, like, half an hour to get connected. Like, I couldn't hear him at all. So we finally figured it out, and he's all, like, on edge because he thinks it's not recording.
Are you giving a play-by-play here?
Yeah. I was practicing my solo episode.
Okay, cool.
It was terrible.
Just practice, buddy. Just practice.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So next up, we've got Matt Massey. He says, hey, guys, I've been meaning to write in for the last couple weeks, but life happens, so I haven't had a chance. I've only heard Jeff's single so far, but I do dig it. I totally agree with Brad B that it sounds like a song you'd hear in a record store, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. The female backing vocal on it is from Angel Olsen. She's pretty awesome. She's a pretty awesome indie singer-songwriter that's a little more rockin' than most. I still find it hard to believe that Chris Cornell is gone. He seemed like he had it completely together, but I guess you never know. I remember that I was up early before work and about to go for a run when I read about him passing on Twitter. I was and still am shocked. I live in the Metro Detroit area, so that made it even more surreal, as that's where Soundgarden would ultimately play their last show. I made a mix of some Soundgarden, Audioslave, and Chris Cornell songs for my run and went off. I never saw Soundgarden live, but I'm so glad that I got to see Chris at PJ20. Him singing Stardog Champion was a true highlight, and I'm not even that big into Mother Love Bone. That dude's voice was amazing, and he seemed like a genuinely good guy. Some of my favorites from Chris's career are Seasons, Fell on Black Days, and my all-time favorite Soundgarden song, Burden in My Hand, which I fucking love that song, too. We should have mentioned that, or I should have. Do you like that song?
Which one?
I had to drop off for a second. What's that?
I had to drop off for a second.
Oh, you did? Did you disappear?
Yeah.
Oh my God, we're all freaking out.
I was letting you practice your solo show.
Yeah, right. You all good?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. It's on Down on the Upside.
Which song?
Burden in My Hand.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Great song.
All right, cool. On to a lighter note, the single soundtrack. I hadn't heard it until I had both 10 and Verses, and I remember State and Breath just blowing me away. They still do. How could two songs that are this good be reserved for a soundtrack? These would have been lead album singles for any other band. Like others already emailed in, songs like Wood, Nearly Lost You, Drown are all fantastic. Though I already liked the hits by Hendrix, May This Be Love really motivated me to dig into his albums track by track. Seasons showed me another side of Chris Cornell. And while I agree, Andy's voice... And Andy's voice usually isn't my cup of tea, Crown of Thorns is an all-time great song. And the bonus disc that came out a little while ago has some great alternate versions and instrumentals. Anyone who hasn't seen the movie should check it out. It's a great movie on its own, but adding all of the band cameos is so funny. My favorite cameo scene, besides the PJ scenes, he puts the Jeff part, which is so... Such bad acting. Poor Jeff. Hey, Cliff, while we're young. That always sticks out of my mind. And when Cliff installs new speakers in Janet's car and turns up the volume until the windows shatter. I love in that scene how Chris is just standing next to him jamming out to the music. All-time great soundtrack. He said he was going to put his top 10 songs in, but he's not ready for that.
I'm not ready. I like that.
But he does say his top 4 never really changes. Number 4 for him is Indifference. Number 3 is Corduroy. Number 2 is Immortality. And at the top of the list for Matt is State of Love and Trust. He says, keep it up, guys. As always, great job. And then P.S. Totally need a Yield episode and a Mirror Ball episode. thanks for the email, man. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, thanks, Matt. I just, before we go on real quick, because he mentioned Jeff's new album, Gene Young on Facebook, he called me out.
And oh, really?
He was correct. I fucked up, and I did listen to the new album, right?
Yeah.
But
oh, that's when we
were when we were recording last week,
oh, God.
I mistakenly pulled up his solo album from 2012. So right. I was talking about like Ulcers of the Apocalypse and Give It a Name, and those are not on
this is the wrong
Heaven
record.
Hell.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So
that's
I just wanted to mention that. But somebody else on Twitter, did you see that someone else was like, Brad B was right about the vinyl. It does look terrible.
Yeah. Yeah, so you sent me those pictures. Like, it does look pretty terrible.
Am I wrong?
No, it's kind of weird.
Okay. Yeah, I mean.
It's kind of gross looking.
Yeah. But go buy it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, our next email is from Jeff Gray, and he says, it dawned on me that the whole podcast is best defined by the section starting with Johnny Cash from last week's episode. Johnny Cash covers, especially Rusty Cage and Hurt, were amazing. Columbo was amazing, and I still remember that Johnny Cash episode. Lost was amazing, but ended in flaming garbage. The fact that I can agree and disagree with comments from both of you in such rapid-fire succession, and that none of it was Pearl Jam, is why I love this podcast. Feel better, Brad L. Thanks for all you guys do, Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff.
Yeah, Jeff.
Appreciate that, man.
Me and him were going back and forth on the Gmail about Lost.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Because I was, I
like
know,
the ending. I'm one of the few people that likes the ending.
No, I did too. But I, you know, it's kind of hard. Like, did he mean the final episode, the end of the final episode, or did he mean like the last two seasons
right.
of how it ended? You know what I mean?
Sure.
So
yeah.
I was curious what he meant, and we were kind of going back and forth, and we pretty much agreed. Like, for me, like the whole. The sideways stuff where they're like in purgatory half of every episode and you don't know what the fuck is going on.
Right.
I hated that shit.
He hit it on the head.
He was like, they didn't want you to know what was going on. Like the flashbacks obviously are flashbacks. And then the flash forwards, like once you figure it out that these are like happening in the future, it's like, oh, this is crazy. This is awesome. But that sideways shit like didn't make sense until the fucking end of the season. And I'm like, it was all confusing and frustrating.
But yeah, but that, I love that was the show. Payoff though, right? Realizing that all this stuff was
no.
No.
Okay. It didn't work for me. All or right. Jeff.
I get it. I just I'm still watching it. I'm still on season one, but
I love it. I love that show. I love the finale and I love the end. I just didn't like that sideways shit. I should say though, like watching it again, knowing
right.
that what's going on, it is a lot more enjoyable. But man, that first watching it live every week, like what is going on?
Getting on the message boards.
And none of
the
shit makes of it makes sense. Yeah. Oh man. I miss Kevin Smith had a message board he took down a couple years ago. But those people on there that was the best message board to go on to like the Lost Threads.
Yeah.
Cuz those people were like genius with the theories and shit that they would come up
insane.
With. But I miss
that's
I miss
what you that get on old, the message boards, the, my friend.
Yeah, I miss that old whiteboard.
All right, enough of our lost podcast.
Who you got next?
We got Kate Cotton.
Kate Cotton.
Hi, fellas. I've been meaning to send you my dream set list since you did the episode, but wanted to revisit one I made a few months ago to see if I needed to make any changes. It's taken me a while to have a second to do that, and now that I finally do, I just looked it over again and barely changed a thing. Lol. There's something to be said for first instincts. I agree with that. The set list I made is, I think, very reflective of someone who hasn't seen Pearl Jam before. I know I saw them 2 years ago, but I barely count that because I wasn't a lunatic fan quite yet, and Beer Through Straws made the night a bit fuzzy. Beer Through Straws. What is wrong with you, Kate?
She's a New York hipster.
Is she? I don't think she is. I mean, she's from New York, but...
Oh, she's from New York.
Oh! That's
They're all hip. They're all... Hey, go get me a beer.
Oh! That's the only thing I can do. She says, this set list is 100% certified unrealistic. There are way too many songs on it, and it doesn't exactly follow their typical patterns the whole way through. But that's what the point of a dream set list is. If it's not exactly what you want. Or what is the point if it's not exactly what you want? Also, I could probably make a whole other set list for all the songs that didn't make the cut for this one. It kills me that I had to cut some of my favorites, like Indifference and Nothing Man. Let's see here. I also didn't really consider many B-sides and covers. I'm mostly stuck to just the studio album stuff I need to see. Anyway, shut up already, Kate. That was her saying that, not me. Here it is. So I'm not going to read all of it because it is a long set list. But, she really was like, fuck it. Like, I'm going for it. Because other than opening with Sometimes, so she got Sometimes as the opener, which is fucking badass. And then once song number two happens, which is Go, it's like balls out and right. for like... Yeah. 10 songs. It's like Animal, Not For You, Last Exit, Mind Your Manners, Save You, Lightning Bolt, Hail Hail. And she says, just like Kate Cotton, there is no chill in my dream set list intro. Then Red Mosquito, and then she calms it down with Love Boat Captain, which I'm so fucking stoked that song made your list. Actually, some of these look exactly like our list. But then she's got some cool encores. I was just going to read through real quick. Encore one is Long Road, I Got Id, Footsteps, State of Love and Trust, Do the Evolution, Blood, Corduroy, and Better Man. Jesus. That's pretty badass.
Long Road, I Got Id, and Footsteps.
Yeah,
I'm just, woo. My heart would explode. And like the tears, I would just be like... dried up from so many tears coming out of my face after those three songs.
Yeah, man. And then encore two is Brain of Jay into Tremor Christ into Oceans into Release into Alive into fucking Ledbetter.
Woo! Yeah.
Man, I love it. She does say top three covers I'd want to see are Baba, Love Rain Over Me, and Rocket of the Free World. She says she wanted to kind of pose a question. One more thing I've been meaning to bring up to you guys. I was talking with my brother at Easter, and he was telling me about something he heard on the radio a few days prior. The host was talking about the most influential music from the 90s, and he broke them up into two tiers of influenced. Tier one, Pearl Jam, Alice in Chains, and Nirvana. Tier two, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Smashing Pumpkins, and Green Day. She was basically kind of asking, like, as two people that were younger, you know, in our teenage years or whatever, when all this stuff kind of broke out, do we see it differently than that? And then says, do you think any kind of generalization when it comes to music is a load of bullshit? What do you think, Brad? How do you approach that?
I mean, I think I'd need some more information, but if her brother is saying that, like...
Yeah, is this a hierarchy tier, or is it just, like, these three kind of belong together and these three belong together?
Yeah, because...
That's what I would want to know.
I don't know, dude. In the heyday, you know, 91 to 97,
mm-hmm.
like, you could have all those bands as tier one.
Yeah.
I mean... Green Day and Pumpkins and Chili Peppers were as huge as Pearl Jam, Alice in Chains, and Nirvana.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So.
Yeah.
But if you, I don't know, as far as like influencing other bands, I mean, I don't know if I'd put Green Day in there. Like they influenced a lot of like the pop punk stuff and like new punk.
Yeah, that was a lot of shit.
But.
That's a lot of bands though.
Yeah, but none of them really stuck.
No, that's true. But, I mean...
You know?
Neither did Creed. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but they're... Yeah. Yeah, but Creed's not in here.
No, I'm saying, like...
Oh, you're
Creed
saying
would be the...
Yeah.
The spawn of, like, the Pearl Jam, Alice in Chains thing.
Yeah, just bring your brother to Chicago, Kate, because we need more information.
We'll
straighten them out.
I think sometimes people make the mistake of when people say 90s, they just automatically go to grunge, which, you know, is not necessarily, it's not the case. Like Red Hot Chili Peppers aren't grunge. Green Day is not grunge.
Yeah.
Smashing Pumpkins, I wouldn't even call that grunge.
Right.
But
well, I mean they're like alternative rock.
Right. I would definitely say alternative, but
All six of these bands at one time were as huge as each other.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I don't know how you if you're going to split them up into tier 1 and 2, I don't know how you I don't know what tier 2 means because I mean Chili Peppers were huge.
Huge.
I mean gigantic.
Yeah. I wore those records out, man. Mother's Milk and Blood Sugar.
I mean, I liked them, but I didn't love them. But I'm saying in
you were too busy general, listening to Korn, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And that what he does?
I do. Yeah. Yeah. I love that you and Clint now, like, think I could do a Korn podcast. Like, I'm so into Korn. I mean, I simply said I like the first few albums. That's it. That's all I said. And now they're like my favorite band.
I'm not letting you backpedal, bro. You said they were your favorite band.
You're gonna put that email out that I sent you?
I'm gonna like purposely do a really shitty job of finding a way to cut like where you said the word Korn. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, you say the word corn, and then...
You know my favorite song?
Is... What?
And then you'll just cut in, like, blind by corn.
Yeah, exactly. It'll be my voice imitating your voice.
I do like... I don't know if you have it in front of you, but she says, listen to your Brad B. You don't get to give me a hard time about anything anymore now that I know you don't like Black Hole Sun.
Oh, what? Yeah.
I just don't. Are you a Martian? That's my favorite line. Are you a Martian?
Oh, so while we're on the topic, real quick,
yeah,
because we have, okay, we'll continue the referring to the Brad Clint Wells and Brad B text thread. Just randomly on Thursday, we get a text from Clint that says, "Blazik, I don't like black hole sun, lions, and the entire planet. How is this possible? Blazik, I'm a metal guy. Lions and the entire planet. The sound of wind in space. An alien makes a fart noise. Blazik shrugs, puts on a 311 record." Oh, God, I love it.
Yeah.
All right, let's keep, we only got a couple left here, so.
Moving on.
Yeah, let's move on. Thanks again, Kate.
Yeah, thank you, Kate. I am a Martian. Tim. Hey, BB, BL. BB, BL.
Yeah, man.
Real quick email. Thought I'd start giving Riot Act some attention, given that it might come up one of these days on Single Podcast Theory.
Well, here you are.
Yeah. It's always been towards the bottom of my list. Maybe tarnished by Bushleaguer. And it's probably the most neglected from my listening perspective. But, fuck me, You Are is absolutely amazing. I can't believe I'm just finding this out now after 15 and a half years. I'm such a dumbass. I could have been loving this song all this time. I remember it was number 4 on Brad B's list, and I remember thinking that was a bit odd, but not now. I totally get it. Despite newfound appreciation for the album as a whole, even though a couple of tracks on the second half still seem a bit of a grind. Thanks again. Without Single Podcast Theory, who knows when I would have figured this out. Cheers. Yeah.
That's what we're here for, man, to lead you down, dude, the valley.
You Are is amazing.
It is.
I mean, we'll get into it here in a little bit. Yeah. Man, I love that song.
I think that song has come up in many a podcast episode.
Yeah.
Between the two of us, you know.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
All right, cool. Thanks again, Tim. Next up, we got our friend Clay. He says, Bradsters, when did he give you a shout out? What'd you say? I know. I love the sign off. When did he give you a shout out about the last couple of episodes? The tribute to Cornell was awesome. I'm glad you both chose to keep it light and more of a celebration of greatness. Hearing you guys pick your favorite tracks got me thinking about doing my own. As I started driving through Chris's huge catalog, it occurred to me that most of my favorites came from one great album, Down on the Upside. That is a kick-ass album.
Mm-hmm.
Look at just how strong the singles are. Pretty Noose, Burden in My Hand, Blow Up the Outside World, Ty Cobb, Rhinosaur. Thinking on it further, I came to realize that 1996 was an awesome year for albums. These CDs saw plenty of spin time in my Pioneer 6-disc changer. Down on the Upside, Nirvana, Live on the Muddy Banks of Wishka album, R.E.M., New Adventures in Hi-Fi, Stone Temple Pilots, Tiny Music, that's a kick-ass record, and of course, the great No Code. The singles episode is also very fun. The album is solid front to back and really does showcase many of the era's best tracks. Most importantly, your banter back and forth is getting so clever and humorous, it leaves you with a great feeling for the rest of the day after a listen. I'm sure I speak for many a listener when I say, it really feels like we are all getting to know you like long-lost old friends. Thank you for that, and please don't change any of the quote-unquote real people moments like barking dogs or stuffy noses for the sake of production. Oh, we won't. As one of the many listeners heading to Chicago to see the shows this summer, I have night two tickets and already am trying hard to get night one. I would like to suggest you guys host a SPT meet and greet on the Sunday between shows. It would be a great way to pass the time between shows, but also make sense for people only able to attend one of the two nights. I think the rooftop of Murphy's would be a great place to host. Use all of your PJ Insider connections to make this happen. lol.
Dude, that
would be awesome. I doubt that could happen, but that would be fucking awesome.
But come on, we are gonna... all our Pearl Jam insider connections, we can make that happen.
Oh, we'll do it.
all none of them.
Right. No, but we will find a place to...
definitely.
Hopefully multiple opportunities to hang out and get people together and meet. So, this is until next time, in the words of Cliff, this negativity just makes me stronger. We will not retreat. This podcast is unstoppable. And then, Clay Davis. Oh, thanks, dude. Appreciate it, man. Yeah, man. We're all going to, we got to start. That's the thing is, I keep thinking about Chicago and I'm like, oh, we got time. But that's like right around the corner, man.
I know.
Oh, my God.
I can't wait.
Yeah. Well, thanks again, Clay. We got one more, right?
One more. John Farrar.
Jay Farrar.
B-Rad 1 plus 2. Salutations. I need to pick up the new Ament record. Safe in the Car sounds like it could have been on Lightning Bolt. The riff sounds like a chunky Infallible. It has that dirty let the records play feel to it. I feel like Soundgarden gets overlooked or taken for granted as the heavy grunge band. They had a really interesting career. We know what Chris and Matt can do. Kim could do anything on guitar, and Ben Shepherd is a really underrated bassist. Dude, he's right. Like, Soundgarden, I don't know, just off the top of my head, like, they really kind of had different sounds throughout their whole career.
Absolutely, you know?
Because they, I don't want to say they got, like, commercial, but they definitely... Some of those first albums sound so different than, like, you know, Down on the Upside.
Right.
Anyway, have you guys thought about having any other guests on the show? I noticed you haven't done a Riot Act episode. Always looking Minnesota, John.
Hell yeah.
I mean, me and you haven't talked about this in a while, but yeah, dude, I think we need to start looking into figuring out how to have people on the show.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I just don't know if the technology.
But there's always a way, Brad.
Yeah. Figure it out. I know. I just want to sound.
Oh, right. Sure.
But yeah.
You don't want to sound like this.
Yeah.
For the whole episode.
Right.
Okay. Cool. Got it.
Yeah.
All right. Is that it for the emails?
I think that's it for emails.
We done did it.
We did.
Thanks, everyone. If you would like to email us, you can find us at singlepodcasttheory@gmail.com. Hit us up on all the socials, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. We're on YouTube. And, if you'd like to support the show, we'll be talking more about this in the next couple weeks as we get closer to... Chicago, like we were just talking about, but Patreon is a great way to support the show. It's really easy. You can go to patreon.com, that's patreon.com/singlepodcasttheory to find out about all of our shit and, you know, stickers and different tiers and all that kind of stuff. So check it out if you're interested.
My wife loves the new marble floors in the bathroom.
Oh, yeah. I know, man.
It's gorgeous. It's
I just bought a new place in the Hamptons, and, you know, it's fine. It's fine. Mm. You know, it's a fixer. The pool is a piece
of
shit.
You know, Chicago, but we can stay in my, my Sears Tower condo.
Okay, cool. I'm down with that.
I haven't even thought about that place.
Can we just camp out on the tower or on the roof of the Sears Tower?
Yes. Yeah.
Just do that.
Oh, in the skybox thing.
We'll have our own little. Yeah.
Are you like? How are you with heights? Are you afraid of heights?
I'm terrified.
Really?
Oh my God.
You know, on the side of the Sears Tower, they have one of those like acrylic boxes where you can go stand.
Oh, I've done it.
Like, oh, have you?
Oh yeah.
Were you freaked out?
Oh yeah. About shit my pants. Like you at the end of the last episode.
Oh, yeah. God. Speaking of, we got some good. If people didn't listen to through the end of last week's episode, there was some fun little tricky hidden bloopers Easter that eggs. You threw it. Yeah, yeah, Easter eggs. So we got December Hotel commented.
Oh, that's
that
right.
He loved that. Yeah. Clint said something about it, and just, I don't know, a couple people.
Yeah, really. Every once in a while.
I loved it. I didn't know it was going to be on there, so I was like, this is awesome.
Good. I'm laughing. Glad you thought that.
My wife was like, is that you?
Oh, you dirty son of a bitch. All right, well, you want to move into Riot Act?
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do it, man. Where was this on your list when we did our top tens?
Oh, God, it had to be 9 or 10.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
I don't know.
I think it was like number 7 on mine. I'm pretty sure it was. I'll
tell you this, after listening to it the last few days, it's definitely number 10.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, dude, you know, we've been doing this for 6 months, and we've kind of, both of us, had this thing about, like, you know, I haven't listened to Lightning Bolt in a long time, but listening to it for the last couple of weeks for the show, like, it's really good. I really enjoy it. I did not have that same reaction this week.
Interesting.
listening, yeah.
So without, I mean, is there anything generally you can say before we get into the track by track?
I read a great, well, kind of a snarky review, but he used one word that was like, yes, that's what I don't like about this album. And the guy said that each song meanders like to insipid heights.
Yeah.
Now, that part I was like, fuck you, dude. But like meander, like, yeah, this album fucking meanders. There's not like a through line of one type of song, or, you know what I mean?
That's very true. Yeah.
And that was like my overall review.
It's funny. I don't remember where it is, but in my notes somewhere I wrote something kind of similar, like along those lines about the meandery type thing. But I like this record. I've always had a complicated relationship with this record because I'm either like in the mood to listen to Riot Act or really not in the mood to listen to Riot Act.
Yeah. Know? Yeah. You said it's complicated. Like, that's like we've said from the beginning, like anytime we do like our favorite songs list or favorite singles or whatever, like, or ranking the albums, I like 99% of Pearl Jam's stuff.
Sure.
So it's kind of like, I feel like I need to apologize before we get into this because I'm going to say stuff that I know people are going to be like upset. Like, how dare he say that song?
Well, that's nothing new, Brad.
Well, that
I'm just kidding.
But I mean, just, I don't know. I don't know if you know me well enough yet to realize, like, I'm like super self-conscious. I don't want people to be like mad at me because I don't like certain songs.
No, because, I understand that. Yeah.
Like, you listen to like Clint, he's super hardcore on what he likes and doesn't like, and he does not give a fuck.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like that internally, but I don't want to say, like,
oh I know. I know.
So just, you know, don't.
Let it fly, man.
Just hopefully, like, two things. Like, I hope there's not someone out there that this is their first single podcast theory episode on top because they're like, oh, they're doing Riot Act, my favorite fucking Pearl Jam album, I'm gonna check these dudes out, and then here's Brad B shitting all over Riot Act.
Is this guy really a Pearl Jam fan?
I don't hate Riot Act. I love every album they've put out, but it's if we're gonna rank them, this is
pretty low for you.
Yeah it's confirmed number 10 after listening to it like a bunch the last week or so.
All right. Well, let's
get into it.
You know, run through some facts. Let's get into this
piece of shit.
This turd of a record. Yeah. You want to do some facts? You want me to? What's up?
How about we'll just bounce off each other.
Okay, I'll start with that? A little right. Release date, November 12th, 2002, recorded in February and May, I think it's February and May, 02.
April.
Oh, April, I'm sorry, you're right.
We're bouncing.
Yeah, Adam Casper was at the helm as the producer this time. He's been their engineer a few different times and a few different records. Let's see here. It went gold. It was mixed by Brendan O'Brien, though. And it was Boom's first record, which is pretty cool. What else you got?
It was dedicated to three bassists who passed away, I guess that year, or around the time it was recorded. Dee Dee Ramone, obviously mm-hmm. the Ramones. The Who's John Entwistle? Yeah. Entwistle? And a jazz guy, Ray Brown.
I didn't know that. Yeah. I'd never heard that before.
Mm-hmm.
Well, but sorry.
The I need you to explain all this. The what? Album, they said it was recorded live.
Yeah.
Does that mean like they didn't like track all the drums over a month and then all right. the guitar stuff over a month? Like they played these songs pretty much like in the room together?
Yeah. Which isn't that abnormal for them. They probably get all their like basics done all together and then overdub like maybe vocals or some lead guitar or stuff like that. But this one was pretty fascinating. I didn't know that they only had two sessions for Riot Act as far as recording. You know, the one in February. It's not like they were recording from February through April. They recorded in February right. and then they came back in April. And you know, I think Stone kind of had a hard time with this record because he wanted to do more of the polishing instead of just keeping basically this record is a lot of not every song probably, but there's a lot of like what started off as demos and then Eddie just cut a vocal and said, that's it, it's done. And no yeah. coming back in and Stone going, well, maybe I could do something different here. Or is that any good? It was just like, no, we're done. This is the record kind of thing. So that's what they mean by live.
Gotcha.
It's a combination and, of a few things.
I mean, I know you don't know specifically, but if they were done recording, and I know there's other shit that has to happen, but they were done in April, mm-hmm. why didn't it come out till November? I mean, is that a normal amount of time to do all the post-production stuff, or is that kind of long?
I mean, if that was all post-production, then it might have been a little bit long, but you also got to look at, like, when they recorded and when's, like, from a business standpoint, when's the best time to release this album? You know, is it early summer thing, which they couldn't okay. have gotten it done in time for that. So the next, you know, kind of thing is like a fall or kind of holiday time release, which is obviously yeah. what they ended up going with. But so sometimes it could have been done and ready to go to stores, you know, 4 months before November 12th. But ooh. They just decided they, you know, for business reasons, you know, release it in November.
Right. Gotcha. You said it was Boom's... It was the first album that Boom was recording with them.
Yeah.
You know, that could be kind of like a subconscious thing of... nothing personal against him, but he's all over this album.
He is, yeah.
And some of these songs. And maybe that's part of why I don't love these songs so much.
Too much...
There's a lot of that...
Keys?
Yeah, maybe.
Huh. It's funny, too, because, like, I don't, you know, hearing, now, of course, well, I'm not going to say that. But, I mean, Mike described the recording of this record as positive and, like, really, I think he said intense and spiritual. Mm-hmm. And Stone had really kind of good things to say about making the record, other than, you know, him having to be cool with it going out the door without really working too hard on it.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's funny, or I don't know if it's ironic that, like, when they made No Code, a lot of them have said, like, we don't like that album, or we didn't think it was that good. Mm-hmm. And that's, like, one a lot of people really love. And it's the opposite with this one. Like, they're all like, yeah, it was great. It was positive, you know? And this one is I know people love this album, but not a lot of people love this album.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
It's regularly ranked lower on most people's lists.
Yeah, I would say it gets a little lost, but...
Yeah.
Well, so this is, you know, the first record after September 11th and after Roskilde, after the fans died, which are directly related to songs like I Am Mine and Love Boat Captain, which is, you know, some pretty heavy fucking subject matter.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, and then we know, you know, Eddie is very opinionated as far as, like, what's going on politically, and that, you know, where we were at that time probably did not help bring in a whole lot of positivity from his side of things anyway. You know what I mean? I mean, it's a pretty heavy record, I guess is the simple way to say it.
I like the quote that he said at the time. Like, he said, I'm optimistic yet disillusioned.
Yeah.
I'm hopeful yet frustrated.
Yeah.
And that's a good way sum up that time, like, in history, in America at least.
Right.
You know, because after 9/11, there was a lot of, like, positive stuff as far as the general public, like...
Just coming together and...
Coming together, yeah. But then, you know, a year later, when all that shit wore off, it kind of got weird. Like, the patriot, like, blind patriotism and that, it's just strange.
Yeah. It went a little nuts, for sure. all right, well, you ready to get into track by track?
Sure.
All right, cool. Well, this is my choice for the opener on my dream set list, Can't Keep. Like this one though, right? Or no? No? Okay. All right, so Save
not,
You.
Not off to a great start.
Okay. What is there? Can you pinpoint what you don't like about it? Everything?
I mean, it's okay. It's like it slowly builds to like nothing. Like it doesn't ever.
It never resolves. It
just, and it's, I don't know. I don't really love the drums, like the, I don't,
really? Is it
like a snare roll? He's like rolling the snare like the whole time? Is that the correct it's way
kind
to
of
say
a,
that?
Kind of a march beat type thing.
Not
so much? Okay.
Mm-mm.
Well, I have in my notes that, I guess the flip side of what you were saying, which is...
Praise, go ahead and praise it, because I don't want to sound like an asshole, so go ahead.
I like the fact that it says that it never resolves, that it's tense the whole time. It never kind of, like, drops into that, like, a release of the tension. And the lyrics are tense along with it. I like it as an opener, for sure. I love the drums.
on this song. That's one of my favorite things about the song. Really weird, creepy guitars going on. Yeah, I'm a fan.
Yeah. Good. I'm sorry.
It's all right. But, okay, so you don't like the Riot Act version, but you love the uke version, right? It's like your, one of your favorite things, the ukulele version. Wasn't that number one on your list of songs you want to see live?
Yes. Yeah, the uke version.
Yeah, opening the show with just Eddie, the uke version of Can't Keep. Right.
Yeah.
That's what you're hoping for in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Dude, you just reminded me. I was with this kid that was helping me the other day. And I think I got an email, a single podcast theory email. So I looked at my phone. I'm like, oh, shit. He's like, what? I said, I just got an email and I was supposed to write this guy back or something like that. And he looked at me. He goes, what's email?
Get the fuck out of here. You're lying to me right now.
I'm not. I had the exact same reaction. And when I looked up at
him. That's bullshit. He was fucking with you.
He was fucking with me.
Okay.
But, dude, he fucking got me so good. And when I looked at him, he fucking broke. And he said, like, you should see your face right now.
Oh, I bet.
It was fucking spectacular. So...
Well done, Brad B.
No, not me.
Well done. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Matthew. Thanks, Matthew.
Yeah, man.
I know you don't listen.
But thanks anyway. Thank you. Man.
Thanks anyway. All right, somewhere out there.
I think you like this one. So let's move on to the next one. Save you. I thought you liked this song.
I do like this song a lot.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it goes
from like, huh?
It's not my favorite on this record.
It's not.
Mm. I don't hate it or anything. Don't get me wrong.
Right. Right.
But
yeah. Now this was after like coming off the like, I don't really care for Can't Keep. This song kicks in and I'm like, yeah. Like,
that riff
this
is badass.
Yeah. I'm like, man, I wish the record started with this song. Maybe that's what I need. I need an alternate track listing.
There you go.
Because I'm like, this song, this is my Pearl Jam, this song. And the lyrics, I know Eddie's been quoted as saying it's basically about watching a friend, like, kill themselves with drugs. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But I always, when I hear the song and the words to it, like, I relate it to my best friend Don. Like, not literally, but like him singing this song to me.
Right.
Like, trying to pump me up and trying to get me out of when I get, like, depressed and shit.
Right.
That's like, I can see him saying these things to me.
Nice little kick in the ass.
And it just, yeah. And it's like, I get a good feeling that this dude cares about me.
Yeah, it's nice.
And it's just, the fucking song rocks. I mean, that riff is crazy, and Matt is nuts. I mean, it's just, it's great.
Yeah, and that's one where the whole band has writing credit for that one. They must have just kind of jammed that shit out. Yeah, it's funny. I don't really have a whole lot to say about this song. It's, I mean, it's cool. I like it. Like I said, I love the riff. I like most of the vocals. I actually, if I had any critique, the chorus just doesn't really do that much for me.
All the swearing?
Yeah, I really, it really turns me off.
Is that what bothers you?
Yeah. But it's a great song.
You know, this was released as a single, wasn't it? I'm sure it was.
I don't know.
We're terrible. Terrible Pearl Jam
really,
fans.
To be honest with you, I mean, by this point in their career, I was kind of... I mean, singles didn't really mean anything at that
that's
point.
True.
And like,
it was their second single.
Oh, it was early? So they just had
to... Yeah. And like, I remember they played it. You know what? He would sing Cuff You.
Oh.
I saw him do that.
He's singing on a late show or something.
Yeah, Letterman. That's what I was just going to say. I remember, because I remember thinking, like, how is he going to play? How are they going to sing that song? And he's saying, Cuff You. And I'm like, Eddie's a fucking genius.
He turned the word around backwards. God damn it, Eddie.
He got
You're so
me again.
Good. He got me again.
He's rude.
Oh, God. I love it. Brad doesn't know. All right, so at some point this will come out too.
Yeah.
It took us a long time.
I know
to
you're
get.
About to say.
Something was going on technically. We're having some difficulties. He couldn't hear me, but I could hear him.
Oh.
And so I went ahead and hit record, and it's just silent except for Brad trying to talk to me, talking to himself. And then at one point I hear you go, something like, I'll have to find it. Oh, there's it. Eddie, swoon. He's just this grown-ass man in his room by himself talking about Eddie.
I was trying to, I was making sure I was getting sound, so I put YouTube on. And put Unplugged on.
Oh.
No, that's what I was watching, Unplugged.
Jesus.
To test my headphones. So.
All right, let's move on to number three, Love Boat Captain.
Just another day, this God forgotten place. First comes love and then comes pain. Let the games begin. Questions rise and answers fall. Insurmountable. Love, boat, captain, take the reins and steer us towards the clear. Yeah. It's already been sung, but it can't be said enough. All you need is love.
I bet you hate this song.
This is the big one that I feel really bad about not liking.
It's like you wish you could like it, but
yeah,
you can't.
Yeah, because I know people love it, and I know it's, I mean, it's about the nine friends that died. You know what I mean?
Right.
And he says that in the song, and it's just like, for that, I mean, I love the lyrics. I love what he's, the idea of what the song is about.
Right.
You know what I mean? All you need is love. Love is all you need. Fuck yeah. I'm totally, I love that. But I just, I don't love the song.
Huh.
You know?
Yeah, this is definitely one of my favorites on the record.
Yeah. And I know people love it. And I get it. But I just, I'm not into it. You know what else? I hate the title. Love Boat Captain? Like... I mean, is he referencing the fucking Captain Steubing? You're laughing,
maybe,
but I'm serious. Like,
just every aspect of the song, you're just like, what the fuck? Well,
yeah,
both agree that the lyric is great, right?
Yes. Yeah, definitely.
Because I like the music as well and the melody and... But he has got a couple lines that have always stuck with me, like the, what is it? The love me and make it the truth. I think that's a pretty fucking cool line. And then just, you know, one of those ways in which for me, whether he's literally saying the same thing in the same context or not, doesn't really matter. But you know, sometimes a singer or a songwriter writes a lyric that you just kind of feel like it's speaking for you kind of thing, or you feel the exact same way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That whole to the universe, I don't mean a thing section of the song. I always loved that because it don't give a fuck about me. You know what
right.
I mean?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's a perfectly serviceable, like, just middle-of-the-road kind of rock song.
Hmm. Yeah. So, okay. So it's bland to you.
Yeah, I don't hate it. Don't get me wrong. I don't hate it, but I don't, like, love it either.
That's all right. You don't have to love it.
But I do,
you can like, even hate it, Brad, if you want to.
Yeah, I don't hate it. It's no dissident.
Oh my god. I'm out.
But I mean, like these words, and the young, they can lose hope because they can't see beyond today, the wisdom that the old can't give away.
Yeah.
That I've always been fascinated with, like, being my age and trying to tell or show my kids, like, when I was a kid, I saw adults as, like, aliens. But now that I'm an adult, I'm, like, the same person I was when I was 10.
Right.
So, like, try to, like, explain to them, like, it's not, you're not different. And you're not going to be, like, a different, totally different person in 20 years. I don't even know if that makes sense. But, like, what I'm trying to say is what Eddie says perfectly.
Yeah, I hear that.
So.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite lyrics, too. I'm glad you brought that one up. And we mentioned the Roskilde reference, right? But,
mm-hmm.
And he wrote that one with Boom. Eddie wrote that one with Boom.
Yeah, Boom tells a story, or I don't know if it's a story, but like he's talking about how he lived in Hawaii and he was just like a musician and he didn't really know like Eddie Vedder, Pearl Jam.
Right.
He just thought of Eddie as his like buddy, his surfing musician buddy. And then they kind of jammed and Eddie was like, are you ready to come hang out in Seattle? And then he, like, realized, like, who this guy was.
That's amazing.
You know? So.
Oh, God. I love Boom. All right. Next up, Crop Duster. Okay, I'm just, what's your temperature on this one, Brad B?
It's better than Love Boat Captain. But it's kind of like, I don't love it, I don't hate it, it's a perfectly serviceable rock song that I don't love.
All right, what's a Matt Cameron song? Through and through.
Yeah.
Now,
let's hear. What do you think of the Crop Duster?
I like the song.
Okay.
I think it's another good lyric from Eddie. That's one thing. I think Eddie's lyrics are good on this record. I do get the feeling, this isn't where I put my notes. I don't, no, it's the next song, which I like the next song too, but, I remember I was out on a tour a year or two ago, and it was me and Clint were on the same tour, and I decided I was going to listen to Riot Act that day because I hadn't listened to it in a long time. And I do remember getting this feeling that, like, the band had these riffs and chord changes and parts and stuff for a lot of these songs, and Eddie comes in probably with, like, a notebook with bunch of lyric ideas written down, and he just kind of would grab one and sing it on top of the music, and like, that's it. Kind of like, not working on it anymore. I'm not saying that's what happened, but that's how it kind of felt. You know what I mean? So I think sometimes in this record, if I was going to critique something, it would just be that sometimes, like, the lyrics are almost better just to read on a page in some ways than how they fit into the songs. That's, I feel like there's a couple awkward moments lyrically.
Trying to find positive things to say about these songs, that's kind of what I did. Like, I just would read the words, you know?
Yeah, find lyrics
like,
that you like.
I do like what he's saying in most of these songs. And this song, too, like, the pre-chorus and the chorus, like, the everyone is practicing.
Mm-hmm.
And then the, like, I thought the world, turns out the world thought me. Like, I'd like that stuff.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you, I'm sure if you listened, but you might not know off the top of your head, like, the guitar in the first verse and the guitar in the second verse are different.
Right.
And I love that second part.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
It's kind of like
the first half
shuffle.
Of the second verse is a little bit different, I think, right?
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
It's kind of, I mean, during the first verse, he's kind of like plucking the strings. And then in the second verse, he's like
kind of doing the stabs.
Like a funky shuffle kind of thing.
Yeah, it's like old, almost like a take on an R&B kind of.
Mm-hmm. After the first chorus, like, the song kind of picks up for me.
Yeah.
Just in that simple change in the guitar, it kind of is like a shuffle kind of thing.
Well, and you know it's Matt because the time signature is 7/4.
Right.
So it's like an odd time signature thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which totally works.
Yeah,
but
it's, I mean.
Okay, yeah. Well, let's maybe move on to Ghost then.
Okay.
Mind is gray like the sea, blackening in and overgrown. Love is deep, figured out, standing in a hole alone. Working for something that one can never hold. A face in the clouds, good place to hide all my own. So I'm
just gonna let you start each one, because I don't. What you got about this one?
I like Ghost.
Cool.
I do like this song. That dirty kind of, that dirty riff.
Yeah, it's super dirty.
Yeah, man. You know me. I love the ladies. I love getting dirty.
Oh my god. You fucking creep.
I am.
No, you're
not. I'm so creepy. No, dude. This is one of the better tracks on the song, on the album.
Yeah, I think, and this is one where I put in my notes, like, I love this song, but if I was going to have a critique, which I guess I don't have to, it does feel a little kind of rambly and droney. Like, it never totally, like, gets to where you feel like it wants to go. It doesn't feel like there's the payoff that you want out of it. But
it's funny because that's kind of like,
that's how you feel about the whole record.
But specifically Can't Keep. Mm-hmm. Like, that's what I was saying about Can't Keep. And now we've, like, switched places because I like that this is kind of a simple drum beat, a simple kind of droning on riff.
Right.
Guitar riff, you know? And I love the, like, away,
yeah.
That part of the, I don't know if that's the chorus. Would that be the chorus?
I guess so. That's the thing about this record, too. And I think maybe this speaks specifically to what we've kind of been touching on, is that a lot of the choruses on this record almost feel like anti-choruses. Like, they could be, if you were going to be real general about, it's more like a pre-chorus.
Yeah.
And it never gets to a chorus kind of moments on this record, you know?
Yeah, none of the songs really have, like, a specific structure, like, basic structure, I guess.
Some of them do, but, like, the next few do, but.
Yeah.
But yeah, I hear what you're saying, totally.
But this song, I think a lot of people don't like this song. I don't know why.
Yeah, I haven't had too many conversations about this song, to be honest with you.
Just online, you know, the online crazies.
Well, it's cool.
It seems like this song comes up a lot. People on like Facebook or on like Reddit, like a fucking ghost. That's the worst song I've ever heard. I'm like,
Yeah, I don't feel that way about it.
And I don't understand. I don't get it. I don't understand why people say that.
Yeah, it seems a little unfair. Of all the songs that you could be that way about, I don't feel like this is one to really do that. But it is cool that, I mean, Jeff was a co-writer in the lyrics. I mean, all the music is Jeff, but he did co-write lyrics with Eddie on this one, which I thought was pretty cool. All right, let's go ahead and do this. Next track, I Am Mine. So I know you don't like the song, and we've talked about it a couple times. We haven't gone into too much depth about it, but I, you know, not to be a judgy asshole, but what the fuck is wrong with you?
I'm a Martian, dude. I don't know. It's too slow, and it's just the, like...
Oh, my God, Brad. You like so many slow Pearl Jam songs. It's because it's slow.
It's kind of like a bad campfire jam.
A bad campfire jam.
Like, I know...
Do you say shit like that on purpose just to get my dander up?
Yes. No, dude. I don't know. I don't know how else to... It's, again, it's another, like, meh song. But, like, the lyrics and the idea of what he's trying to say are great. But I just don't like the song part of it.
God. The chorus is so... I mean, it's like... You could kind of argue this is the first, like, great chorus of the record. You know, maybe this and Love Boat Captain. You could. Your other favorite. I mean, I feel like I've talked a lot on this podcast about this song, but... I mean, it's up there for me. I love this song. I love the lyrics. Yeah.
And this is the other one, like the two big songs that people fucking love that I don't.
Yeah.
This is the other. Like, I feel bad. People have this tattooed, like I Am Mine tattooed on their bodies. Like, I see it all the time.
Right.
Online. People that this, I just got my new tattoo. And I'm like, oh,
to help you add insult to injury, I bet you love the solo section of this song, the guitar solo.
I mean, I'd have to hear it. It's dissident vibes. Oh, yeah, okay.
Really kind of like Southern Rocky Blues kind of solo section.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I Am Mine fans, because I do get like the simple, I don't know, simple meaning of what he's saying, you know, like the time in between is mine or whatever, like that's a pretty cool idea. You know, like, you're born and you're going to die, so in the middle, use that fucking time for yourself.
Yeah.
And I get that.
I mean, what's... The ocean is full because everyone's crying. The full moon is looking for friends at high tide. The sorrow grows bigger when the sorrow's denied. I only know my mind. That is a great goddamn lyric. And a great goddamn song.
But the I'll stop digging. I'm in a hole.
No, I know. I'm totally fucking with you. But I know. I mean, I really don't understand, but I'm totally fucking with you.
But that, the way he sings those words, the like sing-songy.
Okay, we should move on.
It's like a pirate shanty.
I just got the hot sweats. Let's move on to the next song.
You might not want to.
Oh, God. Thumbing my way. Let's do it. You don't like this one?
I Am Mine, I wrote Too Slow for Me. Do you know what I wrote for Thumbing My Way?
What?
Way Too Slow for Me.
Okay. Yeah, okay. All right. I get that. I get that. I can see that. This, of all the songs that kind of fit into this kind of category of this, like, you know, because I think there's like one electric guitar that kind of pops in and out throughout the song. It's all acoustic guitars and like drums with brushes, and Eddie never really gets super intense or anything.
Right. This is kind of like a sequel to Off He Goes.
Yeah, it totally fits into that batch of songs.
Lyrically, and now I love that song.
I mean,
it's... Again, this album is filled with, I don't hate this song, but I don't love it.
Okay. Well, all right. I give up. I don't know how to do this right now. Okay, well, we're all right. All right, so we'll just thumbing just,
low. Dude, power through, because we're about to get into it.
No, I know. We're about to get a happy song for us, but
happy Brad B.
No, I just, I mean, this is an all, you know, Thumbing My Way, it's all Eddie Vedder. I mean, it's his song, I mean, which is obvious by listening to it, but I don't know, to me it's just kind of classic acoustic Eddie. I love this song, but I will why am I trying to like help you out? I don't know why. No, I'm trying, dude, to make you feel better. I guess,
look, I've had 15 years to sit and ponder this album.
Right.
You're not bringing me back.
No, I hear you. No, so, and I'm not trying to. But
dude, praise it. Give the people.
Well, and one thing that I was thinking about earlier today, the last listen through I did was, you know, if you were to put, you know, this song up against the other songs of its kin, like an Off He Goes or something like that, it's definitely not the strongest one. I would agree with that, but I do think it's a great song. It's got again, great lyrics, a great narrative to the song. I like that it's like all acoustic for the most part, which they don't do a ton of, you know?
Right.
I mean, even if Stone and Eddie are playing acoustics on something, Mike's usually still got the electric on. So, yeah, but I love that song. So let's move on to one that we both love, which is You Are.
We'll be right back.
Again, I mean, I don't even know what else to say about this song because we have talked about this song so fucking much.
Yeah.
Because we love it.
Side two kicks off with that fucking weird reverb-y guitar and drum.
Yeah.
That, again, I know we talked about it, but explain to me, that's a guitar being played through a drum machine?
Is or like a sequencer kind of thing. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
With like reverb on it, it's incredible. It's such a fucking cool, weird Matt Cameron song.
Yeah. Well, I know we mentioned before too, but that guitar that we love was lifted straight from his demo, you know? Like, they didn't go back and re-record based off his demo. They took that guitar part from his demo, and that's kind of what they played to, which is pretty fucking cool. Yeah, I just have, like, in all caps, love it. It's, Yeah, like you said, Matt Cameron helping out with the lyrics with Eddie, and all the music is Matt's. I mean, that spot, again, I've said it before, when he sings the lyric, "Love is a tower and you're the key," just that lift right there, but it's still fucking creepy and groovy. And
It's a weird song. It sounds weird.
Yeah. I mean, the bridge is super cool and fucking weird. Mm-hmm. The Mike Whale Call guitar sounds at the end of the song, just that really vibey, ethereal stuff. Sorry, I had to bring that back. Everyone that's new to the podcast, I know that it's ethereal. This is an old inside joke we're bringing
back. He's making fun of me.
Yes, I am.
Which I'm fine with.
Yeah, I think there's just a lot of power. It's such a slow tempo and such groove. It kicks ass live.
People, you want an I Am Mine tattoo? How about I'm the shoreline, but you're the sea? That's your goddamn tattoo.
Do you hear that, everybody? Get that tattoo. Brad B says so.
Hey, all what do you call it? Full disclosure, is that how you say it?
Yeah,
I think I have a tattoo that is fucking awful and I hate, so I'm allowed to make fun of other people's tattoos.
Well, you want to get a bowl of nachos tattooed on your body, right?
Yeah, but that would be awesome.
No,
not a bowl of nachos. No, it's like a chip, an anthropomorphic chip.
So like a tortilla chip with human like qualities?
Yes.
Oh my God, Brad. That's a terrible idea.
No.
Where would you get it? I forgot.
On one of my legs.
Oh.
Like the side or like my calf.
Okay. All right. Well, it's kind of weird, but hey man, do your thing. I fucking support it.
It's that or I Am Mine.
God, that would... Man, I'm gonna...
I must sound like the biggest douchebag.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just kidding. Oh, shit. All right. Yes, we're huge fans of UR. So let's move on to Get Right.
In the haystacks, water is sunshine. Wait for the moment between us. The fire is made now.
so harsh.
Okay, you like this one?
Yeah, fuck yeah. Okay, another rocker.
All right,
another
cool.
Rocking weird guitar sound like that. Beep, 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 beep. Like, what is that? What's going on there?
The what?
The weird
that one
guitar
note that just
sound.
Keeps...
Yeah.
Nah, nah, nah. I mean, I don't think it's anything crazy. He's just doing like an octave thing, probably on like the root or the fifth or something.
Is he just holding that note?
One of the guitars is, yeah.
Okay, all right.
I don't know who's doing it, but yes.
Yeah.
It's just that one note while the other changes like, keep moving.
That weird sound with Jeff's bass line just fucking ripping through underneath.
Dude, Jeff is so good.
Yeah.
He's great on this record, too. He's great on all the records, I think. I don't think I've ever listened to a Pearl Jam record and been like, Jeff, what are you doing, man? You know what I mean? He's always a badass.
Yeah.
But
those, go on.
No, nothing. I was just going to say this song, like, I don't have super big attachments to the song or anything, but as far as this record goes, it's another one of my favorites on this record. And it's like much needed place to kind of pick up some energy a little bit, you know?
Yeah. Oh, and those fucking hand claps.
Yeah.
Like I don't know. It's so fun.
Yeah, and this is one too that I thought I didn't know this, but Matt wrote everything. Matt wrote the lyrics and the music for this one, which I did not know that literally until today. It's pretty cool.
Matt is the fucking like unsung hero.
He's the shit.
Yeah.
All right, let's go to Green Disease. Think, Brad?
I love it.
Another oh, all right, fucking, man.
Yeah,
a little positivity at the end of the record.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Oh, just wait. Yeah, but go.
Oh,
on.
It gets better.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Oh, fuck yeah, man.
I think I'm gonna all surprise right. you here.
Come on.
No, I do. I like this song a lot.
Yeah, this is an all Eddie song. It's got a really interesting chorus. And maybe it's an interesting chorus because it's not really a chorus. I don't know. There's sections where there's just... unless he's just playing really high up in the neck, it sounds like there's not really any bass for, like, turnarounds and stuff like that, which I thought was really interesting. But I don't know. I love it.
And I did not know until today that he's spelling out the word greed with a D at the end. When he's doing that G-R-E-E.
Oh, really?
I thought he was spelling out green, because the song's called Green Disease.
Yeah, man.
So when I, like, brought up the lyrics, it's spelled out with a D at the end. I'm like, I'm so fucking dumb.
Excuse me, I have one question. Why am I a fucking idiot? Chicago. Oh, Brad, it's late. Oh, God.
Yeah.
We are so... All right.
No, this is Eddie always shines on his lyrics that don't... they have two meanings. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. The double entendre.
Yeah.
All right, let's move on to Help, Help.
This shit's
Do you like Help Help?
I do.
Oh, okay. Did you have to think about it for a second? What was that?
Yeah.
I do. Or were you fucking around on your computer? Your 15 windows open.
No, I was giving you... You fucker. I was looking up Korn lyrics.
Did it just say...
It says Jonathan .. mouth orgasms.
Fieldy is such a good bass player. Clang, 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 clang. Are you going to play some notes, bud? What? Clang, 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 clang. Oh, God. Let's never talk about Korn again.
No, to go back to why I paused, I was doing like built-in editing. I was letting you put the song in there.
Oh, okay. Thanks, bud.
Oh, you're welcome.
That was really sweet.
You're such a sweetheart. I hope you feel really bad now about making fun of me.
What song are we talking about again?
Help, Help.
Exactly.
This is just a weird Jeff Ament song, and I hadn't listened to this song in a long time.
Yeah, it's but weird.
It's a lot better than I remember.
Yeah,
it's not great, but it's weird, but it's good enough that I'm like, I should have listened to this more over the years.
That's good to hear. That's cool. So you kind of turned the corner a little bit on Riot Act song. Yeah. I like it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's super strange, but I like it too. Eddie's vocals weird. Cool pre-chorus. Really unnerving chorus. It can be a good thing when a song can kind of stress you out a little bit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's talk about Bush Leaguer, dude.
Such a happening tailpipe of a party. Like sugar, the guests are so refined.
So, you, Mr. I don't like politics, even though you have lots of thoughts and ideas on politics and feelings.
Yeah.
This one, I'm assuming, didn't really tickle your fancy.
Back in the day, no.
Oh, okay.
But this, along with Help, Help, like... I should have listened to this. I should have paid more attention to this song over the years, because listening to it this last week, I'm like, you know, this song is pretty cool, like musically.
I don't know if it's the podcast or what, man, but I'm really starting to kind of like open myself up a lot more than I thought I would to the quote unquote weirder stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I now, never hated this song.
I mean, I didn't hate it, but the whole like I hate politics. Like I'm not a Bush supporter. I doubt I would be considered a Republican. But when this song came out, I was just like, I don't want to hear it. I don't care. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And not because I'm like, oh fuck them. They're making fun of Bush. I don't give a shit about that. I just like they're doing politics, and I don't want to hear it. You know?
Yeah, well, and at that time, too, it was like, it's kind of it is now. It's like all you heard about was...
Yes, exactly. You know. So I didn't really pay attention, but good God, man, listening to it today, I don't know if I care so much of the, like, slam poetry verses.
Yeah.
But, like, the fucking blackout weaves its way through the cities. Yeah, dude. Like, that shit is killer.
Yeah. Some Stone Gossard shit.
I remember when you sang that song about today, holy shit. It's a good song.
It's good stuff, man. Him and Stone.
Yeah. It's a cool song. But yeah, the just the politicalness of it and the verses of him like clicking snapping his fingers.
And his decanter.
Yes, exactly. What is that hat with the little nipple on the top? That like French.
The nipple hat.
What do you mean? That French hat. That French hat.
Yeah, the nipple hat.
Yeah. Oh,
that's what it's called.
What's
what they call it in France. Le nipple hat.
Yeah.
That's what how they do.
Okay. Well, when I asked them for that, they looked at me like I was crazy. You're telling me that's what they call it?
Oh, no. You should definitely go back there and do that again. Okay. Ask them for that again. Maybe try the accent this time.
Yeah. Oh, that's what it was. I was doing it in my
Chicago. Yeah, you were like,
where's that nipple hat?
Chicago.
Nipple hat. I'm from Chicago.
You can't just walk into a place and say, nipple hat, Chicago.
Now I got it.
All right. It was your delivery, man. That's probably what it was. All right. All right, let's do Ark.
Let's not.
Oh, that's actually pretty good, Brad.
Yeah.
I mean, not it wasn't that song, but you were doing some, I think you got some quarter tones going on in there.
Yes, something.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of those like, hey, Eddie, buddy, I'm glad you explored it. I'm glad you did it. I'm glad you put it on a record. Let's move on.
Yeah.
All or none, dude. What do you?
Great, great fucking slow burn of a song. Love it.
I'm so glad that we're ending on a positive note here.
Yeah, this song's great. It's up there with Immortality and Indifference.
Ooh,
it's
just, really?
Yeah.
I couldn't put it that high up, but I love this song.
Oh, man. I love it.
Why is it, man, up there with, did you say Indifference and Immortality?
What song are we talking about? Did we skip a song?
Oh, God.
Okay, yeah.
Did we?
We skipped Half Full.
Oh, my bad.
So that's what
I didn't turn my page.
Yeah.
Okay. We were talking about two different things.
On a lonely highway, east of Omaha. All right. Sorry.
What was that? Do that again.
Turn a page.
Okay, so where are we now?
Okay. All right, Half Full.
Half Full. What'd you think?
Jeff wrote that, right?
I'm pretty sure, yes.
Jeff did all. I like that song.
Yeah,
it's kind of like bluesy rocker.
Definitely, yeah.
But even though it's got the kind of.
You don't like that, but now you like this one, but moving on.
It's kind of got a whiny guitar in the beginning.
God, I'm so sorry to cut you off, but this one I'm going to. I should have brought a pen in here. I'm going to make a compilation for when we hit 1 year where you go, I take one little snippet where you're like, yeah, man, it's awesome. It's all bluesy and it just fucking rocks, man. And then the next one it'll be like, oh, no, I don't. It's bluesy. I don't really like bluesy. It's like they're like jamming and stuff. You're just completely contradicting yourself all the time.
I'm just a big old hypocrite.
That's you, hypocrite Brad.
Oh, man.
No, I shouldn't like this song, but I do.
That's good.
You're right. You're right. It's a song that I wouldn't normally like, but yeah, I like it.
All right.
And Matt's bass drum kind of sticks out to me. I don't know if you've noticed that, but it seems like it's louder, maybe.
Huh. I'll have to go back and pay attention. Yeah.
But yeah, but that's Mike's fucking solo.
Yeah, he definitely rips it.
I mean, yeah, it's a great song.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a fun one. I'm down with it. I'm like middle of the road with it.
Come on, don't see some men as half empty. See them half full of shit. Like, just the way he sings that part, I'm like, yeah.
Yeah. Those, I think it's just, fucking, to be honest with you.
Those fucking empty suits.
Man, you're getting angry over there.
I like side two.
I haven't spent a whole lot of time with this song, so I don't have as much to say about it. I like it, but...
I'm pretty sure... Let me look at something before I say it. Yeah, they played this in Lexington, and I've listened to that Lexington show a lot over the last 2 years.
Mm.
And so I've kind of... I'm more familiar with this song probably than any of the other ones on this... Well, besides You Are.
Hmm.
But yeah, I like the song.
Cool. All right, well, now let's get to All or None. Are you joking with me right now?
Half joking.
Well, I mean, we already talked about it.
Yeah. All right.
I mean, do you really have?
Yeah.
Oh my God, it's so late. I feel like I'm losing my mind. You're trying to sing Indian music in my ears. Your poor family. Are your dogs barking yet?
Dude.
What? Usually does not go well when I hear you say that.
Because isn't ARC like five different vocal tracks and then he mixed them together?
Oh, it's a bunch. Yeah, it's probably
mine. Let's do it. I will record myself and you mix it together.
Oh, my God.
Do the Brad B.
All right, send me the tracks.
Cover. I'm going to do it. I'm going to fucking listen to the song.
It's going to be unlistenable. So as long as you're cool with that.
You didn't even give me a chance.
All right, we'll give it a chance.
Hey, come here. My daughter just walked in. Look at your shirt. That's so cool. She's laughing. She's making fun of me. That shirt. Is that how I laugh?
Yes, that's what I come
say
in.
Hello.
Oh,
say hello.
I'm so glad this is going to be on the podcast.
And everybody needs to hear this because I'm great.
You are great.
Thanks.
How's work? I love that shirt. Where did you get that?
I got it at Target.
That's so cool.
Thanks. I like this part.
Yeah. It's got some moons on it.
What? Some moons on it.
She just turned around and mooned me.
Oh,
not
God.
For real, but like she like
I'm so tired.
Pretended. Yeah, me too. Give me a hug. I love you.
I love you too.
How's work? Great slow burn of a song.
Yeah, I love
it's
this.
It's up there. It's up there with Immortality and Indifference.
So let's get back to that. Really?
For me. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's, right? I mean, isn't I'm that just the saying... two, that's the, I get those fucked up. That's the two songs that close out Versus and Vitalogy, right?
Yeah.
Indifference and Immortality.
Yeah.
Okay. Because there's another song, I think, on Binaural.
There's lots of songs on Binaural. What do you mean?
Insignificance.
What about it?
I get that confused with Indifference. Because it's Insignificance.
Gotcha.
So I wasn't sure if I was saying the right song. But yes, Immortality and Indifference. Yeah, it's that real, like, just chill, turn the lights off, smoke a cigarette, just contemplate life. Yeah, man. Like, all these years, I've just loved this band. And now they're playing this song, and it's like, won't someone save the world?
Oh, my God. You need to go to bed. It's night time for Blazy.
Yeah. No. Yeah. This song doesn't do that for you like those do.
Not to the extent that those do. No, but I love this song. I mean, this chorus gets stuck in my head all the time.
I mean, if I had to rank them, it would be third out of those three.
Right. But okay.
Well, then we're on the same. It's okay.
Yeah. Cool. I love the chorus. It gets stuck in my head a lot.
I'm glad you agree with me.
Oh yeah. We're brothers.
Oh.
It's one that I don't think to, like, seek out, but every time it ends up coming on, whether it's, like, on a shuffle or something like that,
right.
I get super stoked.
Yeah.
It's a bitchin' song. Absolutely. Well, I'm glad we made it through a record that you're not that... I mean, like you said, you don't, like, hate the record, but, you know...
Yeah.
It's not up there for you.
It's not a turd. It's not fucking, like, Lulu. You know, Metallica's Lulu or Saint Anger.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
But I just don't... I don't love it overall. Like Lightning Bolt. Like, I don't love every song on Lightning Bolt, but mm-hmm. I'm much more hyped up about listening to that.
Than this.
Or Avocado.
Yeah, that makes sense. I get that.
So... But goddamn, dude, those You Are and Get Right and Green Disease, like that's a pretty good triple play of songs.
Yeah, there's some barn burners on this one for sure. Well, we did it, my friend. We only got a couple records left to do.
I know.
It's crazy. Well, thank you guys again so much for listening. If you'd like to support the show, check us out. Go to patreon.com, patreon.com. You can email us. The email address is singlepodcasttheory@gmail.com. We're on Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, The Porch, all that good stuff. So come say hi. You got anything else, bud?
I think that's it.
All right. Well, we'll talk to you guys next week. I'm Brad Lyon.
Hey, hold on.
Oh, God. I knew it.
Thank you, Janan.
Oh, we didn't say
for this week's intro.
Yeah, that's right.
Dude, you got to cut something in. We'll just cut something right now. Like, and thanks to Janan for the intro.
Right. Okay, cool.
Put that back in the beginning.
Well, that sounded really fake and sarcastic. Like, it was fuck you, Janan.
No, you gotta cut that. I didn't mean it like that.
I know what you're saying.
Like, sarcastically, because we're doing it at the end.
Mm-hmm.
But the meaning of it is, like, thank you so much for doing an intro. And
I'm leaving all this in, by the way. So
right. I feel awful. I feel awful that Brad Lyons fucked up and didn't ever put it in.
Yeah. Okay, that's all right. I'll eat the shit sandwich this time, Brad B.
You can leave that in?
Yep, I am. So everyone can hear how vindictive you are.
I told you over and over to put it in, and I was like, every week, like, why didn't he put it in again?
All right. You're getting a dick punch next time I see you. That's a fact.
No, dude, we love you, Janan. Thank you.
No, seriously, thanks, Janan. And I don't know how we... I don't know how it got thrown out of the rotation.
We talked about it, and we don't know what happened.
Yeah, because we're
terrible people.
I think we called each other when you sent it. And we're like, oh, my God.
Yeah, it was
sent
like one of our favorites.
Yeah.
But, speaking of intros, like, come on, people. Record an intro.
Yeah, give us some more intros, people.
Email it in.
Just do it on your voice memos if you have an iPhone. And
do it on your
phone. I don't know what the app is for Android, but I know that you got to have
silly
one.
Androids.
Oh, God. Oh, God. All right, cool. Well, thanks again, Janon. Thanks for everyone writing in. Thanks for listening. And until next week, I'm Brad Lyons.
And I'm Brad Blazek saying, baby, let yourself fall. I'm right below you now.
Oh, trust fall. Thanks, hon. Peace.
Later.
Oh, God.
Oh, God. It's too
late,
how do
we have
man.
A show?
I don't know.
That was fun, though. I had a good time.
Yeah. All right.
I died and you walked by and said, no, I'm dead.
Ah, that was fine. Fuck yeah.